demonstrated on Channel 6 running a 16-horsepower tractor engine off of water. And it was obvious that when we were doing this at that time, we could hook a gearbox to that 16-horsepower tractor engine and now attach an electrical generator to it and produce electrical energy by using the fuel cell. When you look at Scripture, go back and look in Ezekiel's wheel. The only reason why we have not put a manned satellite in outer space is because we have a logistic problem. The logistic problem being is that we can't transport standard fossil fuels in outer space economically. But when you're talking about water fuel cell technology, releasing phenomenal amount of energy in a control state, I mean, 108,000 barrels of oil is quite a lot of energy, right? You can sustain and maintain a space station in outer space. So just exactly as Ezekiel had prophesied, that in the end time you will see that man's satellite will now be put out there, and when you look at its design, look at Scripture. When you look at an American space station, look at its Scriptures, and you will see a wheel within a wheel. And that will be the power supply that will... The only place I found out where I was going was straight to hell, and I was getting there fast. When the Lord started revealing himself to me and started talking to me and subsequently been filled with the Holy Spirit, I've been exercising the gifts of the Holy Spirit and exercising the power of faith to bring in this power supply in this country. But you see, the Scripture says the Lord raised up a weak man and makes him strong. In all of my business life, I had hit my head against the world banking system, which has a pretty good vehicle capable of capturing and controlling technology and manipulating technology. I finally arrived in 1975. You cannot beat them. You must join them. Then the Lord turns around and says, now I want you to put a power supply in the country. If it was not to do one thing, the Lord said to me, greatly I have given unto you, and greatly I expect in return. The power supply, the purpose of the power supply, is to help to aid and finance the last major command in the Bible, to spread the gospel throughout all the world, and then the end time will come. So my responsibility as a scientist, that once truth is shown unto me, truth will always prevail, so therefore I have a responsibility to relate that truth to the guy, my next-door neighbor, the guy down the block, the guy down the next part of the city, the next town, the next state, or next country, to relate the Word of God. Because, see, I own my relationship on the Lord Jesus Christ because he gave me eternal life. And there's no price tag that you can put on it. If you do not understand this aspect of me, you'll have a hard time to understand my motivations for you. When you go home this afternoon or this evening, I want you to look up Job 38, verse 22 and 23. This is on my logo. The reason for that is that as the Lord started dealing with me pertaining to the technology on water, after all, the Lord created heaven and earth, right? You ought to know how to be able to split the water molecule economically. When you look at Job 38, verse 22 and 23, it says this. It says, have you considered the treasures of snow, or have you considered the treasures of hell, which I have reserved against trouble, against battle, and war? And this is where the Lord is talking to Job, asking Job this question. Now, the interpretation of these scriptures are as follows. Snow is the most beautiful part about water, is it not? You ever look at snow with the little snow crystals? And no one snow crystal is the same as that of another? The treasures of snow is a characteristic and knowledge of water. Phenomenal principle pertaining to the water molecule. As I pointed out, the Lord created heaven and earth and created elements. He also created the ability of releasing the energy from ordinary natural water. And what he had shown me was that, in fact, that if I would set up a voltage zone on opposite side of the water molecule, and if I would expose these voltage zones to a water molecule, a phenomena happens. And what takes place is that the hydrogen atom will become electrically charged. The oxygen atom will become negative electrical charge. And once the water molecule becomes electrically charged, then on the opposite polarity attraction, anyone ever hear that? Law of physics? Opposite charge will attract, like charges will repel. On the opposite charges of attraction, the hydrogen atom, being positive electrical charge, will be attracted to the B-plus voltage zone, and the oxygen, being negative electrically charged, will be attracted to the B-plus electrical voltage zone. And if you're switching off the amps to prevent consumption of amps or consumption of power and allowing voltage to take over in a dead short condition, then voltage will absolutely influence a disassociation of the water molecule. Now, by electrically charging the water molecule, you're simply now switching off the covalent sharing of the water molecule. Now, for you who know in chemistry and electronics, you know that an electron is negative electrically charged. When the hydrogen becomes positive electrical charge, that sharing of electron moving back and forth between the atoms no longer can be shared because opposite polarity attraction now causes that negative charge electron to go to the positive charge hydrogen atom. Conversely, since the oxygen atom is now negatively electrically charged, you have a repelling action which repels away the sharing of that electron, and as a result, you're now switching off the water molecule in the most economical way. We have found out that through lab experimentation and certification testing that the electrical polarization process occurs in all forms of natural water. We have found out that in our lab experimentation that when you subject the water molecule to a high intensity voltage field, you find out that as you increase the voltage, hydrogen gas generation goes exponentially. Prior state-of-the-art was a linear function based on the amount of flow of amps going into a system because it was a dead short condition. By restricting the amps, we're not consuming power. By utilizing voltage, we are now producing gas on an exponential rate. But who was the gentleman who filled this fuel cell up? You did. Have you seen me before today? Have you ever talked to me before today? Good. I believe truth is a very powerful thing, and no matter what anyone else says, truth will always prevail. So I always like to get somebody involved in this that I have no part in doing it. Now, let me ask you some embarrassing questions, if I may. What did you put in this fuel cell? Where'd you get it out of? Sink out of the back room? Did you fill this up with ordinary natural water? Okay. Now, did you process this water in any way? You didn't process it in any way, shape, form, fashion, right? Did you add any chemicals to this system? You didn't. Okay. Now, if this guy's lying, you get to beat him up. Okay? As I said, I believe truth is a very powerful thing, and no matter what anyone says, truth will always prevail. Now, as we pointed out in our presentation, the water is a free energy source, is it not? And if I don't have to process the water in any way, does it cost me anything? If I don't have to package the water in any way, does it cost me anything? Therefore, water is a very economical source of fuel if you can release the hydrogen oxygen atom economically, right? Now, over here we have a little apparatus that allows the voltage to take over and restrict the amps in it. Now, for those who have never seen the process or have not seen the process, come on up. I'd like to show this and demonstrate it to you. Now, what we're going to do here is to actually show that, in fact, that by restricting the amps, voltage take over, that voltage does, in fact, influence the disassociation of the water molecule. Now, I'm under the prior state of the art says the average potential of a fuel cell was around 2 volts, and then you socked in as many amps as you possibly can, because when you put an electrolyte in the water, now, the purpose for the electrolyte is that the still water is an insulator to the flow of DC current. So they have to add an electrolyte to the water in order to electrify the water to allow amp flow to go into the system. So automatically, a amp device or electrolysis process is a dead short condition, operates in a dead short condition. And because of that, it will not allow voltage to come up. It socks in as much amps as it possibly can. So under the prior state of the art, around 2 volts potential, you can see that there's no form of hydrogen gas being developed. Now I'm going to now adjust the attenuation of voltage amplitude upward, and I'm going to adjust it to such an extent that only allow just the hydrogen and oxygen gases now to be developed. Now, you see these gases coming up? You're now producing hydrogen and oxygen gas in the most economical means. Now, I'm going to use you as an experimenter here. I want you to put your hands on there and tell me if that's a cold or hot process. Is it cold or hot? Cold. Okay, now, if you can sit down, and then I'm going to have you come back up and forth. Now, leaving the power supply exactly constant, if I renewed the voltage zones inward, I'm leaving the electronics exactly constant now. The only parameter that I'm changing is the physical parameter of the voltage zones. Now, I'm going to adjust the voltage down because I'm producing it too high. The purpose is just to show you the phenomena. Now, I'm going to adjust it downward. Leaving the electronics exactly constant, the only parameter I'm changing is the physical parameter. As you bring the voltage zones in, it influences the dissociation of water molecule even faster. So as I do this now, tell me if the hydrogen gas is being increased. Wait, I shut it off too much. Let me do it again now. Murphy's Law came into existence. All right, now when I move the voltage zones backwards, tell me if the hydrogen gas slows down. Did it slow down? All right, now moving the physical parameters together again, tell me if the hydrogen and oxygen gas being generated is now being speeded up. That, in fact, shows, in fact, that voltage does influence the disassociation of the water molecule. And when we present this to the examiner chief of the United States Patent Office 101, showing operability, they stated, in fact, that there was no other form of apparatus that we needed to show that voltage does influence the disassociation of the water molecule. Now, as a counterproof to this, we move the voltage zones backwards to one-end spacing, and I now should be able to attenuate the voltage upward, and increasing the voltage upward should increase hydrogen gas generation. Now I'm going to raise it up a little bit and tell me if the hydrogen gas speeded up. Did it speed up? All right, now I'm going to lower the voltage down and tell me if it slows down. Slow down? All right, now I'm going to adjust it up again. Now, do you see any hidden tube or anything in the apparatus? This is ordinary little 18-gauge wire, by the way. Did it speed up? Okay, now over here, to show you another form of the... We are not demonstrating in this to you under the ideal conditions. All we want to do is to show you basic principles that we have solved the engineering design interfacing capabilities of utilizing ordinary natural water as a new energy source. Now, if I can sustain a hydrogen and oxygen flame well over 5,000 degrees under controlled state, then it's quite obvious that I'm releasing energy from water that if you shove it into a carburetor, you could actually run a car down the road on water, right? Now, I have over here, as we mentioned earlier, that this is a pulse voltage frequency generator. It's actually a car alternator. This car alternator is actually now is a pulse voltage frequency generator by eliminating the voltage regulation. Now, let's see what we can do with an ordinary car alternator converted into a pulse voltage frequency generator. Number one, can we demonstrate the ability of producing the hydrogen and oxygen gas economically? Second area was the ability to develop the ability to control the hydrogen gas on demand. Maestro, I want you to notice, see if there's any hoses or anything around there. You see any of that? Is there any hoses? All right, I'm going to have Charlie now barely adjust.
We'll start it slow. It's harder to start slow than it is fast.
Now, see the hydrogen and oxygen gas being produced? I want you to put your hands on here and tell me this is cold or hot. Tell me if that's cold or hot. Tell me if it's cold or hot.
Basically,
it's a cold process, right?
Volts in your amps.
All right, now, here's your volts and here's your amps. I'm going to allow Charlie to adjust it at 5 volts, around 2 amps. I want you to look at here and see if we now can control the rate of hydrogen production.
Watch this and I'll figure out.
Did it increase? You see an increase in it? All right. What's your voltage? About 5 volts. About 4 volts. What's your amps? We know around 2 amps or about 8 watts of power going in the alternator. Now, when you look at the gauge here, if you see the gauge, that gauge is not in ounces, gentlemen. It's in pounds of pressure. It's not in ounces. I want you to look at the gauge, if you will come up, and I want you to look at the gauge and tell me what pounds of hydrogen we're at right now. Okay, now I want you to look at the rate of the needle, the speed at which the needle's moving now, and I want to have Charlie up the voltage and tell me if the needle will speed up. Now watch it now. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm going to lower it. Did it slow down? Okay, now I want you to look at the needle now and tell me if it's moving at a constant rate. Is it moving at a constant rate? All right, I'm going to have Charlie now up the voltage and tell me if the needle will speed up. To speed up? All right, now I want you to look at the needle and tell me if it's moving at a constant rate. All right, put your hand on here put your hand on here and tell me it's cold or hot.
Stop.
Was it instantaneous? I want Charlie to do this again. He's going to illustrate that this constant demand, just as fast we're producing the energy, we are now consuming it. I want you to look at this as an instantaneous response to voltage. Did it start up again? All right, again, tell me if that's cold or hot. What poundage are we at? About 8.5 going up to 9 pounds, right? Do you feel any gas coming out of there? Come on up here. I want you to put your hand on there and tell me you feel any gas coming out of there.
Yes.
Well, how can gas come out of there? You only put water in it, right? Okay, now when you burn... That's right. Now, when you burn a hydrogen, you cannot see it, nor smell it, or taste it. It's a very clean burning fuel. You're going to see a small part of the flame. Don't let that bother you. It's well over 5,000 degrees. The part of the flame that you'll see is the ambient air that's being mixed with the hydrogen and oxygen gas to support a pure hydrogen and oxygen flame, which is well over 5,000 degrees.
Whoa.
Okay, now set it up. Yeah, it's there. Turn it out now. Now, you see that flame? Now, you're witnessing for the first time, in a true scientific terminology, the ability of burning ordinary natural water. Now, we're sustaining the production of hydrogen gas at the same rate of the generator. Now, we are adjusting the hydrogen burn rate automatically down to around 47 centimeters a second. Now, what Charlie's doing is taking an ordinary paper clip that has a high metal alloy in it, and as you see that hydrogen flame is actually melting that paper clip. Now, it's not the size of the flame that counts, it's the amount of energy that's being released from the flame. Charlie's taking the match and trying to expose it to the paper clip. It would take a flame well over 200 times greater in size and energy capacity to get it to a point of trying to melt it. Now, if you don't believe me, go home and take a butane torch and try to do what we're doing with ordinary natural water. And we're releasing the energy under controlled state. Now, I want this gentleman here, if you put your hands on the fuel cell and tell me if it's cold or hot. It's a cold process, right? Now, there's an outfit out in California that's been trying to duplicate our process of an apparatus that costs well over $1.5 million to do this. We are using the water as a gas mixing regulator and producing the energy on demand basis. And as you see, Charlie can take it and use it virtually as a cutting torch. Now we're going to demonstrate that because we're using the water as a gas mixing regulator, we can maintain the combustion rate of the hydrogen gas irregardless of the generator. Turn the lights back out so we can demonstrate this. Now to demonstrate this is that hydrogen burns in a very narrow window. But because we're using the water as a gas mixing regulator, we can control the combustion rate of the hydrogen gas regardless of the rate of the generator. Now I'm having Charlie lowering the voltage, and as a result, you're going to see the flame go downward, but the flame is maintained. Now this is very important because we can maintain the combustion rate regardless of the rate of the generator. We now can hook it up to your car or hook it up to the furnace, or we can hook it up to some other form of energy device and know that we're going to maintain that combustion rate. Under prior state of the art, that was totally impossible. Now see the flame going down?
I want you to come back up.
Now I'm going to have Charlie up the voltage, and now you're going to see that the hydrogen flame is increasing. Now, mind you now, I'm saying that we are demonstrating this under the worst conditions, not the most ideal conditions. The ideal condition, we can release enough energy to blow a roof off this place, and I don't have the money to pay Deer Creek for the reconstruction of the building, and I'm sure they wouldn't ask us back. All right, now I want you to tell me again, is the fuel cell hot or cold? Still cold process. Now, I want you to put your finger on there and tell me if that's hot. Now, I did that. Is it hot or cold? Just a hair warm, right? Well, how can we support a flame well over 5,000 degrees? And now put your finger on it. Let me ask you a question. How can you be able to support a flame well over 5,000 degrees and yet this thing does not become super hot? The reason being is that we developed a patented quenching circuit which has the ability to prevent anti-spark back into the generator. This now makes the generator a self-sustaining or very self-sustaining style generator, because under Murphy's Law, whatever go wrong would go wrong. It's electronically interfaced. We could shut off the system if any form of malfunctioning would occur.
You're going to shut it off on me now that I'm playing with it?
Yeah. All right, put your hand again and tell me that's hot or cold.
Might be
lukewarm.
Just
barely warm. Okay, now if you go sit down, we'll go on with our presentation. Now don't, yes?
How long would that stay that way?
Until the water go out of the fuel cell or reduce down that the water would go below the exciter element. In other words, you keep supported until you consumed all the water out of the process. Huh? All right, that's stainless steel, 304 material. Now, as I questioned this man earlier in the presentation about the water, he said he used natural water, right? No chemical additives, did not process it in any way. Now, if any inventor says to you that they've come up with a design concept or an invention that has all pluses and no negatives, get up and walk out. I'd be doing the same thing. There is a negative aspect to the fuel cell, but it is a blessing in disguise. Now, as a man testified that he was using ordinary natural water. Now, you notice the colorization in the water here? Now, since we're spinning the water molecule by the influence of voltage, any form of contaminants in the water remains as contaminants. And as a result of that, the contaminants remain in the fuel cell. The liberated hydrogen oxygen gas is now being combined with the ambient air that's in the water and adjusting the burn rate downward and supporting a high temperature plane. So,